Well, glory.
Glory.
Last Sunday night, I preached a message called the Cyrus Season. I titled it the Cyrus Season. And I normally don't get up and, you know, push tapes or videos or whatever. But we recorded that on our...
it's online right now.
It's online right now, yeah. On the Facebook page?
YouTube, our YouTube
channel page, whatever. And I encourage you to listen to that message. Not because I preached it, but because, you know, just like we talked before, when Jesus showed up on the earth, he was the will, plan, and purpose, and move of God for that time.
Right.
And the Bible tells us that as New Testament Christians, we're to redeem the time. How do you redeem time? By understanding the will of the Lord. That's what it says there in Ephesians. Understanding what spiritual season are you in? What is God wanting to do? What's he doing in your life personally? What's he doing in the earth in the general sense? And the Pharisees didn't get that. They didn't understand that. They were trying to fit their, what they believed, into the season instead of finding out from God what season they were in. And so as a result of their lack of knowledge, the Bible says my people are destroyed because of a lack of knowledge. Most of those Pharisees ended up destroyed because of a lack of knowledge. 30 years later, the Romans came in and either killed or took everybody captive.
Right.
Amen?
Right.
And Jesus looked at them one day and he says, you guys can look at the sky and tell me, you can predict the future by the sky and tell me whether it's going to be raining tomorrow or not.
Right.
Then I'll hire them for the weatherman. But yet you don't know the signs of the times.
Right.
And the word times there in the Greek is the word kairos, which means that which you ought to be doing with the time you have. Or in other words, the spiritual season, the will of the Lord.
Yes.
And so we're in a time right now, and actually, two Tuesdays ago, sitting over here praying, the Lord spoke to me, and he said, it's a Cyrus season in the earth right now, and he began to show me, there's an anointing, the same anointing that came upon Cyrus in the Bible, to open the door for the people of God to go back and have the fullness of their inheritance.
Right.
Is that same mantle or anointing that's upon the earth right now. And you and I need to cooperate. How many of you found out the people that cooperated with Jesus and the move of God that was happening through him, they got blessed?
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen?
People have the idea that Jesus just went around healing everybody. He did not.
Nope.
He did not. As a matter of fact, some people came to him and he says, what do you want? And blind Bartimaeus, he says, I want my eyes open. He says, be it unto you according to your faith. In other words, he's telling him, I don't have any word from the Father. I don't have any gift of the Spirit. I don't have any anointing, you know, falling on me to minister to you. I haven't been directed to you. But you came to me and recognized who I was and what season we were in here. And so be it unto you according to your faith. And when he used his faith to attach himself to what Jesus said and who he was, he got healed.
Yep.
He partook of the season. Amen?
Yeah.
So that's the general sense of what we've shared, but there's a lot more to it, and I encourage you to listen to it, because I think it'll help you adjust your thinking to where we're at right now. Because the Cyrus anointing causes a lot of havoc.
Yes.
It's a shifting. It's an uprooting of things. It's a bringing down of some kings and lifting up of others. It's a time of transition.
Right.
Yeah.
And if you look at those things from a natural perspective, all it does is make you afraid. You feel unsure and afraid. But if you see it from God's perspective, you're able to take advantage of it and walk in the blessing that God has for
you.
Amen?
Yes.
So I want to share this morning. Let's turn over to... where do we start? Let's go ahead and turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 1. 2 Chronicles chapter 1. Praise God. Now I want you to really listen this morning, not just with your outward ears, but seriously ask the Holy Spirit to show you. See, it's not so much what I say, it's what He says about what I say. Yeah.
Right.
Amen. Amen. So ask Him to give you revelation.
Yeah.
This morning. I want to talk to you about wisdom. Everybody say wisdom.
Wisdom.
Actually, not just wisdom, kingly wisdom. Because the Cyrus season is a season of a king.
Yes.
You know, in the Hebrew year of 5777 that we're in right now, That translates pictorially out to a sword with a crown on it. This is the year of the king's sword. This is the year of God the King, Jesus the King, using his sword. Now, what kind of sword does he have? The Bible says in two places, it's a sharp two-edged sword that comes out of his mouth.
Yeah.
In other words, it's his words.
Yes.
He can use his words like we would use a sword in the natural realm.
Yes.
Over in Psalm 149, it says that when the high praises of God are on our mouth, it's also like having a two-edged sword in our hand.
Amen.
Right. Amen. Just praising God defeats the enemy.
Yes.
Notice we started praising him this morning, and the devil got defeated in some areas of sickness and disease.
Yeah.
Praise is one of the most powerful weapons that's at your disposal. But the sword of the Lord, this is the year of the sword of the crown sword, the sword of the king. Now the king, sits on a throne in heaven, makes decrees. The Bible says in Hebrews 1 that Jesus, after he completed his work of undoing what the devil did through Adam and Eve in the garden, after he rose from the dead and was ascended into heaven, that he sat down at the right hand of the Father. Now that's implying that he became a king, or he became a ruler. Because kings sit on thrones.
Amen.
Priests don't ever sit down. In the Old Testament tabernacle, all of the stuff that was in the tabernacle, the menorah and the showbread and all the different implements and things that were there in the Old Testament temple or tabernacle, even in the Holy of Holies where the mercy seat was, there was no chair, there was no place to sit down.
Right.
Priests never sat down. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 1, verse 6, that you and I, New Testament Christians, have been made, because of Jesus, through him, we've been made kings and priests unto our God.
Amen.
Our priests, we just got through being priests this morning.
Yeah.
We worship the Lord. We minister to the Lord. That's what priests do. They minister sacrifices to the Lord.
Yes.
The Bible tells us that we're to offer the sacrifice of praise.
Yeah.
The fruit of our lips giving thanks to his name.
Yeah.
See, that's the priesthood ministry. As we go to the Lord and pray for other people, as we minister to the Lord, as we worship him. But then there's the other side of it, and that's the kingly ministry. And we're not in the year of the priest, we're in the year of the king.
Yes.
We're in the year of where God is going to shift some gears, and he's going to use us as kings.
Yes.
And we don't have time to go into it this morning, because we shared a little bit of it on the Sunday night when I preached the other message. But Jesus came into this earth, and when he was ready to minister, he pulled out Isaiah 61, and he read it to his home church. He decreed, he was actually, if you look the words up and dig into it, you find that he was like a town crier. How many of you are old enough to know what a town crier is? A town crier, back in the old days, the king, seated on the throne, would make a decree which became law. And then the officers or the people in the throne room took that out, shared it with other people. They got on their horses or whatever, and they went to the different villages, they went to the different cities, and they shared with a person that was designated to work for the king, for the government there in that town, and that person became a crier. They would many times use a bell or some kind of implement to get everybody's attention. People would come together, and they would say, over in England, the way they used to do it was like, "Hear ye, hear ye." In other words, hear what the king has to say, because it's become law. And then they would speak out, they would decree on behalf of the king. They were the king's voice in that village. Now the Father's in heaven on his throne, Jesus is seated at his right hand. They're making some decrees about the season we're in, and the Holy Spirit has communicated that to us and revealed it to us in his word and by his Spirit. And now you and I are called to go out into the world and decree.
Yes.
We're to not only decree the gospel to people through the Great Commission and share the gospel, but we are also to decree in this earth, into the spiritual atmosphere, the season that we are living in.
Amen.
You know, sometimes you have to tell the devil. Let me tell you what's going to happen, devil. You're not going to tell me what's going to happen.
Amen. That's good.
Amen.
Amen.
The devil tries to tell you what's going to happen every day of your life through your thoughts.
That's right.
Anybody ever go a day in their life without having one negative or maybe discouraging thought? No. Why? Because the devil's faithful to his job. He knows the only way he can run your life is if he can get you to believe what he's saying and inject the spirit of fear into that, where he can intimidate you, manipulate you, and control you. Because he doesn't have the right to come and just take over your life. He has to talk you into getting an agreement with him on it. Amen. But you and I, have, by the Spirit of God, have been given something to decree and say every day. And sometimes you just have to decree it right in the devil's face. When he gets in your face, get in his face. Well, I don't want to get too far away from what I want to share here today. Kingly wisdom. Look at your neighbor and say, you need some kingly wisdom today. Hallelujah. And then say, so do I. 2 Chronicles. We're operating as kings. God's wanting us to. He's wanting us to take them in. He's wanting us to be his voice. He's wanting what he has decreed in heaven to flow down through us into the earth and happen on the earth. That's why Jesus taught his disciples, your will be done on earth. To pray, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God wants what's happening in heaven to happen on the earth. And the devil wants us to think that, well, you know, we just sit back and if God wants to do it, he'll do it. It's never worked that way from Genesis chapter 1. God spoke, recreated everything, set everything up, created man and woman, and then said, now you take dominion over all this. And if you don't take dominion over all of it, then the devil's going to deceive you. Now, he didn't say this specifically, but we read the Bible in chapter 3 of Genesis, we saw it happen. The devil's going to deceive you, and he's going to use the spirit of fear and deception to dominate. So it's always been that man has to take dominion over the planet. Amen? So kingly wisdom. Here we have the story of Solomon. Solomon's David's son. David wanted to build God a house. He had a heart to build him a house, to build a temple. And God said, nope, not going to let you do it. He said, you shed too much blood with your hands. That's a whole different story, a whole different sermon. We won't get into that today. But what he did allow David to do, because David had the wisdom and the understanding of how to keep the glory of God on the land.
Right.
He set up something called the Tabernacle of David, which was a tent where the Ark of the Covenant was brought in. He appointed people to 24-7. Their job was to worship and praise God. In shifts, they worked, and they were there to proclaim, they were there to play music, they were there to worship consistently, because David had inherited a nation that had been spiritually abused, and a lot of religiosity that had caused the presence of God to move back away from the nation. And of course the devil always blames, you know, when God's not there, he blames it on God. But it wasn't God's fault, it was the people, that were the priesthood, it was King Saul, who was in kingship before David, and bottom line, inevitably, it was the hearts of the people. So David comes in, he sets up a form of worship to where people were conscious of worshiping and praising God, and for 40 years the nation lived in victory, and the hand of blessing was upon the nation in every area.
Right.
David acquired so much wealth, he was able to pile up what we would call millions and millions of dollars today to pay for the temple. He didn't... You know, he didn't get all of it. His son Solomon inherited, he understood that wisdom and walked in it, and he became the richest man that had ever lived on the face of the earth in order to build the temple and do quite a job. If you study the word, you'll see that it was beyond. And the scriptures say, God even told Solomon, you're going to have more wisdom and be wealthier than any person that's ever going to live.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now let's read here real quick before I get too wound up. Verse 1, chapter 1. Solomon the son of David was strengthened in his kingdom, and the Lord his God was with him and magnified him exceedingly. Then Solomon spake unto all Israel, to the captains of thousands and of hundreds, and to judges, and to every governor in all Israel, and the chief of the fathers. So Solomon and all the congregation with him went to the high place that was at Gibeon. For there was the tabernacle of the congregation of God, which Moses, the servant of the Lord, had made in the wilderness. But the ark of God had David brought up from, however you say that, to the place where David had prepared for it. For he had pitched a tent for it at Jerusalem. Moreover, the brazen altar that Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, had made, he put before the tabernacle of the Lord. And Solomon and the congregation sought unto it. Now here's the whole nation up here before God. And Solomon went up thither to the brazen altar before the Lord, which was at the tabernacle of the congregation and offered 1,000 burnt offerings. Everybody say 1,000 burnt offerings. Now, if you study, you find out that the Jews never did anything just haphazardly or flippantly when they worshiped God. There was purpose. Excuse me. There was reason and purpose in everything they did. Solomon was acting on something that Moses had decreed in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 9. Moses in Deuteronomy 7, verse 9 said that the Lord had made covenant with them as a nation to 1,000 generations. Everybody say 1,000 generations. So Solomon understood, all right, I'm the king now, and it's my turn in my generation to see to it that this nation is blessed, that we walk in the covenant blessings of God. So he went to God in humility and an understanding that as a man, he wasn't going to be able to do this in his strength or wisdom. That's the first thing we all need to figure out, amen. And not only are we not going to be able to start it in our strength and wisdom, we're not going to be able to do it or finish it in our strength and wisdom. You know, sometimes people get a little blessing in their life and they start getting a little haughty. A little prideful.
Yeah.
All of a sudden they start thinking they know what they're doing. And you do know what you're doing in some areas. But there's the seasons of life, there's always, God is always going to begin to move in a way that you don't get.
Right.
It's like he had to tell me on Highway 99 about, I don't know, 3 years ago or however long it was, that I didn't even understand my own ministry. And I'm like, great, I've been preaching for 30 years, pastoring a church, and I don't understand my own ministry. That'll pop your balloon. And he told me, no, I'm not saying you haven't understood everything you've been doing. He says, what I'm saying is what I want to do now in you and through you and with you and what I want and where I'm taking you, you don't understand it. Seasons were changing. Things were changing. So that's why we stay in humility. That's why you need to meet with God every day if possible.
Yes.
And I'm not talking about, you know, trying to memorize the Bible. I know guys, I've talked to guys out here on the street that know the Bible better than me, but yet the devil's dominating their life.
Right.
You can know what the Bible says. That doesn't mean it's working in your life.
Right.
But when you humble yourself under the mighty hand of God on a daily basis, I come to God because I want him to hear what I have to say. I want him to answer my prayers.
Right.
And he wants to. But more than that, I need to hear what he has to say to me.
Right.
Because he understands it all. I just understand a little bit of what I understand.
Yeah.
Right. Amen?
Amen?
So Solomon understood this. I need to have the anointing, the wisdom, the ability of God to do my part. Everybody say, do my part. In my generation. Jesus updated this in his day over in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. He was talking to the disciples because they were, you know, starting to worry about food and clothes and the things, the cares of the life and all that kind of thing. And he said, listen, seek first in time. That word first means in time. Prioritize. Put God first in your life. Seek him first. It says, seek first the kingdom and what's right in his sight, and everything else in your life will find its place, fall into its place, and be what it needs to be in your life.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. A lot of people run around they waste their whole life chasing their tail like a dog trying to fix their life.
Yeah.
I've done it. Been there, done that, been down the water slide, got the t-shirt. Amen?
Amen.
You all, and it's human to try to do that. But when you find out that if you get with God and you just take your life and you lay it all out on the altar before him, you let go of it, you know, you put it in the fire of God, so to speak.
Right.
And you just say, here I am. I want to talk to you. I want to be your friend. And that's really what he's wanting.
Yeah.
It's in that friendship. See, it's when Adam didn't consult with him in that daily walk in the cool of the day in the garden, and he got in trouble.
Right.
He missed God.
Yeah.
And it cost him. His wife ate him out of house and home.
Yeah.
Yeah. Bad joke. He took a bite too, didn't he?
Yeah.
They ate themselves out of house and home.
Yeah.
Anyway. Old preacher joke. Back to the anointing. So that daily listening to God. See, the enemy of the new move of God Because God's always progressing and expanding. That's all in the Bible. The enemy of the new move of God is the old move of God. Because we're, you know, we walked with God in one season, and we saw this and understood that. And even in our prayer life, my prayer life is totally different now than it was 5 years ago. And so there's this time where you step into this place of humility. It should be every day, really. And then God can communicate things to you that you need to know. And some of it, you'll look at it and go, what do I need to know that for? Or you may not even get it at first. But as you stay with Him, how many of you had Him, as you spend time with Him, keep turning you back to the same scripture over a period of weeks? Anybody? What's He doing? You're not getting it. I remember years ago, when I first started pastoring, I thought I had to have this hot, new, heavy, revy every day, every Sunday, you know, on Sunday morning. I had to have this new thing from God and all this. And the Lord spoke to me one day. He said, John, I'm going to have you preach some things over and over and over and over and over again. Yeah. And I said, why? He says, because I'm going to have you say it until you and the people get it.
Amen.
I remember one time, the church I was in, it was a powerful church. I was a part of it, Fresno. It was a tremendous move of God. Pastor was preaching, teaching good things. This one brother, a friend of mine, actually I went to high school with him even, he came up to me and he goes, he just preaches the same thing every Sunday. I'm sitting there thinking, who are you listening to?
Amen.
And so I asked the Lord, I said, what's that all about? He says, he's hearing the same thing because he won't do what I tell him to do, and I'm going to tell him the same thing until he does it. And then we can move on. The pastor can get up and preach on the book of Revelation, and he's going to hear whatever God's saying to him.
Yep.
Hallelujah. Amen. So the Lord is good enough, if we'll just be humble enough, He's good enough, and He's going to help you plug into Him and walk in the wisdom and the understanding of God for your generation and what He's wanting to do right now. That's what Solomon understood. So he walked up before God, and he understood that and you'll see it in his words here, but he put that 1,000 sacrifice out there saying, God, I take a step into the covenant words of Moses based on 1,000 generation covenant promise from you. It's my turn to do this, and I'm standing on that word that I will have your covenant and whatever I need from you to do what I'm supposed to do.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Verse 7. That night, that's pretty quick. That night did God appear in Solomon. See, when you pray the right prayer for the right motive, God shows up.
Amen.
Word.
That night God appeared to Solomon and said unto him, ask what I shall give you. How would you like for God to show up in your bedroom one night? Well, I'm supposed to pass out if that happened anyway. I probably screamed like a little girl. We think we're spirits, you know. Until something actually happens. Anyway. He says, what do you want me to give you? Now, why would God ask that guy that question? Because he claimed the 1,000. Well, no. That's what brought God on the scene. Because God always honored his word.
Amen.
Solomon's right. I said that by my servant Moses, and I'm showing up. But he asked him, what do you want? What was he doing? He was saying, what's your heart like, Solomon? What's your heart motive? He wasn't asking him, you know. I hear people use this scripture like, the Bible says God will give you the desires of your heart. But wait a minute. You forgot the first part. When a person's ways please the Lord, he'll give you the desire of your heart. Why? Because when you have a heart for Him, your heart and His heart are going to be the same, come together, and then He can give you the desires of your heart.
Amen.
And I'll tell you right now, His desires are far better and greater than your desires. Anybody ever push God for something and I want it, I want it, I want it, I want it, and then you get it and you go, I didn't want it, I didn't want it, I didn't want it. Now that I've got it, I don't want it. Take it back! Praise God. We want a king, Lord. We want a king. God says, I'm your king. No, we want a king. Okay, here you go. I'm going to give you one just like you.
Yeah.
Word.
King Saul. He says, what shall I give you? Verse 8, Solomon said unto the Lord, you have shown great mercy unto David my father, and have made me to reign in his stead, or in his place. Now, O Lord, let your promise unto David my father be established, for you have made me king over the people like the dust of the earth in multitude. You think he got stressed? He's put in this position of being king, and it says there's so many people who are like the dust of the earth. Yep. And you're going to be held accountable for doing right by all of them. Shaddai. Verse 10. Give me now wisdom and knowledge that I may go out and come in before this people. In other words, give me the wisdom and knowledge I need to be to you and these people what I need to be.
Yes.
Right. Yes.
Notice he didn't say, heal my body, fill my treasury full of money.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Right. He said, give me the ability to fulfill the purpose you put me on this planet to fulfill.
Right.
Amen. Yeah. Praise God. That's what Jesus was saying in Luke 6:33. Lord, if you'll seek first the kingdom, God's going to show you who you are and what your purpose is. And when you, with a heart of gratitude toward God and a heart of blessing toward others, go out and begin to live in that, then everything else in your life is going to get fixed by God. Because now you're no longer in the darkness of deception and aligning yourself with the devil without even knowing it, to where he's able to access your life and mess it up in the darkness that you're walking in. He will persecute you. He will come against you, but he won't defeat you. Because you're working in the walking in the purpose of God, and all of heaven will come and protect you, bless you, back you up, help you do. Even when you make a wrong decision out of your head, God will show up and correct you by his Spirit because you're open to him, you're listening to him. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Give me wisdom, he said, to judge. That I can go out before this people and come in and go out. For who can judge this thy people that is so great? See, he knew what. See, have you ever felt what God asked you to do is bigger than what you can handle?
Yeah. Sure.
I heard Gloria a couple one day say, she asked the Lord, Lord, how come all these things you tell us to do, it looks like it's impossible? He said, because it is. Yeah. It's impossible for you. But without. But with me, nothing's impossible.
That's right.
And not only that, he's going to do it through you. You're not going to do it for him. Amen?
Yeah.
God said to Solomon, because this was in thine heart, your heart motive, Solomon, that you've not asked for riches and wealth or honor. It wasn't on an ego trip. Hallelujah. It wasn't a look at me, look at me, look at me. And when we don't look at you, you poor me, poor me, poor me. Nor the life of your enemies, neither yet you've asked for long life, but you've asked for wisdom and knowledge for yourself, that you may judge my people over whom I have made you king. God, just help me do what I need to do the way I need to do it. With the right heart and the right place. God says, that blesses me when you ask me things like that. Amen?
Amen?
Verse 12, wisdom and knowledge is granted unto you, and I will give you riches, wealth, and honor, such as none of the kings have had that have been before you. God's blessing on your life is going to be far greater than you could ever obtain on your own. Well, I don't understand that, Pastor. What about all these evil people that pile up all these billions of dollars and all that? Well, study your Bible and you'll find out. It says that the heathen heap up riches to give it to the righteous. It says that wicked people like that, it'll look like they're spreading themselves out like a big Green Bay tree, a big beautiful tree growing, and looks like they're prospering even more than God's people. But the Bible says suddenly they are cut off. What good is that? Work yourself half to death, piling up all that stuff, and then die. Somebody else gets it. Hallelujah. Don't shut me down because I'm preaching. Glory to God. Verse 12, wisdom and knowledge is granted unto you, and I will give you riches and wealth, honor, such as none of the kings have had that have been before you. Neither shall there any after you have the like. Then Solomon came from his journey to the high place that was at Gibeon to Jerusalem from before the tabernacle of the congregation and reigned over Israel. When Jesus was on the earth, of course, there again, the Pharisees and Sadducees, and you know why the Sadducees were called the Sadducees? They were sad, you see. You heard too many of my jokes. If I was living the way they were living, I'd be sad too. But in one place over in Matthew 12:42, we won't turn there, but in Matthew 12:42, Jesus was answering some of their questions, and here's what he said to them. One greater than Solomon is here. Speaking of himself. Jesus is a king, isn't he? Seated on the throne in heaven. And Solomon had a lot of wealth. He had so much wealth that when the Queen of Sheba showed up, because she'd heard all this stuff and she thought, yeah, right, it's probably over-exaggerated. She showed up, it took her breath away. She almost passed out when she saw the glory of his kingdom. Yeah. Now, when you're a king and you make other kings and queens almost pass out because of your kingdom, that's a wild kingdom right there. Amen? Praise God. So how did all this happen? It was wisdom. You know, David, over in Proverbs, Proverbs begins with David. Proverbs he wrote to Solomon. Proverbs chapter 3, my son, attend to my ear. My words. How's the rest of it going? Incline your ears unto my sayings. He began to share with Solomon, teach Solomon the wisdom that he'd operated in so that he could have, you know, live his life in his generation and be to Israel what he was called to be. Amen?
Amen.
Now, David messed up in life like we all do. He majorly messed up. Amen? But his heart was toward God. He would repent when his sins were discovered, when his sins were shown to him. He didn't try to push it off on somebody else and say it's somebody else's fault. He didn't try to deny it. He didn't try to hide from it. He went and fell on his face and admitted it before God and poured out his heart to God. He humbled himself. Come on, are you here? Amen. So he began to teach Solomon. And we see where, for one thing, let's turn over there. Turn to Psalm 127. Psalm 127. This is a psalm, Psalm 127. My Bible here, it says, a psalm of degrees for Solomon. This was a psalm that came through David. His father was a psalmist. They called him the sweet psalmist of Israel. He had an understanding of ministering to the Lord. And as he ministered to the Lord, his music ministry and his ministry of psalms and so forth was so filled with God, so powerful, that when evil spirits would come on Saul, just David singing a song would drive them off. Why? Because the Bible says God inhabits our praises. Amen? And so this psalm came to David to give to his son an inheritance, a spiritual inheritance. Look at verse 1 and 127. Except the Lord build the house. Now the word house here, if you look it up in the original language, it doesn't just mean the building, it's talking about the people, it's talking really about the family, the home. Except the Lord build the house. Now what was Solomon called to do as a king? Build the Lord's house. Amen? Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord guard or keep or watch over the city. The watchman waketh but in vain. Those of you that are intercessory prayer people that have given yourself to a ministry of prayer and that are watchmen on the wall, as the Bible calls us.
Yes.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Where Jesus said, watch and pray.
Watch and pray.
Amen?
Yeah.
Those of you that have it, notice even here he says, unless the Lord is working through your prayer ministry, you're praying, you're wasting your time.
Right. Yeah.
See, what he's showing us here is there's an interaction that has to happen with God in relationship and fellowship so that the Holy Spirit, who knows everything about everything, is communicating through us. He's praying through us. He's travailing through us. He's praising through us. He's petitioning through us. He's doing whatever. Maybe downloading us with information for us.
Right.
Amen. See, the Lord needs to be intermingled and involved in all of this.
Yep.
In our life. It comes all the way back to God's original intent. He wants to walk with you and talk with you. And if you don't walk with Him and talk with Him, much of what you're going to try to do as a Christian is going to be labor in vain.
Yeah.
That's why it bothers me when we have prayer meetings and a lot of people don't show up. Because if you don't know how to pray, get with people that do.
Yes.
Come on.
There's a learning curve to prayer.
Sure.
There are people that have spent their lives in the prayer closet, and they've learned things about prayer, and learned things about walking with God, and learn. And when you get around them, there's a spirit of prayer that's on them.
Yeah.
I love getting around Lou Engle. I don't know if you know who he is or not. But that guy, you get in the same room with him for 5 minutes, and what's on him jumps on you. He has such a strong spirit of prayer and intercession on his life. It just gets on you. And so, you know, if you're going to try to be a Christian and basically live by the principles of the Bible, and we need to live by the principles of the Word, but principles without relationship, that's no different than somebody in the world who just decides, well, I'm going to pay my taxes, not kick the dog, be nice to my wife or husband, and you know, and not rob anybody. That's good, but that's not totally God.
Right.
What we're doing here is something supernatural, beyond just being a nice person on the earth.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
And sooner or later, because see, the enemy is always out to deceive you. He's always out somehow to, if he can't push you, he'll pull you. He can't get you to quit on God, he'll try to push you into something that looks like God. Paul's biggest problem in establishing churches when he was alive on the earth as an apostle, and he wrote about it a lot, he said, another gospel. People are false apostles preaching another gospel. It's not the gospel. It's another gospel. And see, if you walk with God, God will show you things out of His Word. He'll connect you with the right people, and He'll help you stay in that pristine place. Not that you'll know everything all the time. We grow in God. You know, we mature and grow and understand. But you'll be able to stay in a place where God can bless you.
Yes.
And so if you don't know what prayer is really all about, and you've been frustrated in trying to pray, you need to get to prayer meeting and get around people that do pray and let God teach you by precept and example how to pray.
Amen.
How to fellowship with God.
Yes.
That doesn't mean that you don't do it at home on your own. You just sit up. You know, I don't like to use the word pray because there's so many different definitions out there. I want to hang out with God.
Yeah.
Amen. Come on.
I want to take time with God.
Yes.
I remember when I was trying to figure all this out years ago. This one man of God, I saw the power of God in his life, and I knew he prayed a lot. And I said, how long do you spend in prayer? What's your prayer? He says, let me put it to you this way. He said, if you and I are friends, he said, if I came to your house to watch a football game, we're just going to sit out on the couch there, and we're just going to hang out together, watch the game, and talk. He says, that's what I do with God.
Amen.
Yeah. It's good.
He wants us to be his friend.
That's right. Amen.
And there'll be times when he just starts downloading you with understanding and information, and you're just like, wow.
Yeah.
Amen. Hallelujah.
There'll be other times where you'll just sit there in peace.
Yeah.
Amen. Hallelujah.
The peace of God is powerful. It's so powerful, Jesus stopped a storm with it.
Amen.
Yeah.
And he told us we can have it. He said, I'm leaving it with you.
Amen.
To use.
Yep.
There's so many things we experience and know in the prayer closet.
Yeah.
And being with God.
Yeah.
It's not about trying to live out of a rule book. If it just becomes a rule book to you, then that's how you're just going to try to keep a bunch of rules, and the enemy is going to deceive you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what the Pharisees were into. They didn't know God. They knew a little bit about it.
Right.
The children of Israel in the wilderness. The scriptures say in Psalms that Moses knew his ways. Why? He knew him.
Yeah.
If somebody came to me and said, well, Karen Pursell did this. I've known her since I was 16 years old. And I know her ways. Boy, do I know her ways. And so you're going to tell me, no, I don't believe that.
That's right, amen.
Because I know her.
Yes.
Amen.
Yeah, that's true.
It says, Moses knew his ways, but the children of Israel only saw his works.
Right. That's
they saw him destroy Egypt. They saw him bring water out of the rock. They saw him, you know, do all the things that were done. But they didn't know him.
Yeah.
So as soon as the pressure was on, what happened?
Yes.
God's trying to kill me.
Yep.
It's Moses' fault.
Yep.
Moving right along. Hallelujah. Psalm 127. Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain to build it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman watcheth, but in vain. Now look, here's a, you're going to love this verse, verse 2. It is vain for you to rise up early and to sit up late to eat the bread of sorrows. What is the bread of sorrows? Worry. It's vain. For he gives his beloved sleep. Are you one of his beloved?
Yes.
That's what it says in Ephesians. It says you, because you've been born again, have been accepted into the beloved.
Yes.
Into the beloved. So would you please be loved?
Yes.
Won't you let him love you?
Yes.
He's not loving you based on your track record. If he did that, none of us would be loved.
That's true.
He's loving you based on the fact that you're his child. He created you, and he created you as a father. He wants to have a family. He wants a fellowship with his family. He wants to get down in the floor and have fun with his kids sometimes. If you don't believe me, just invite Joe Jordan to your house. Some of you in here know what I'm talking about. Amen? He wants us to be loved. You know, we sing a lot about loving God, and we need to love God. Jesus, you know, of course, quoted that out of the Old Testament, that, you know, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and your neighbor as yourself.
Yeah.
We're to love Him. Don't, I find the biggest problem is people won't let Him love them.
Because
the devil tells them they're not worthy.
Yeah. Right.
Somehow they don't qualify.
Yeah.
But how can you qualify for be disqualified from something you never qualified for to begin with? Jesus qualified you. He did all the work to qualify you. And then he just said, here I am. Give me your old life. I'll give you my new life. So the devil would have to disqualify Jesus to disqualify you. You know why it's quiet right now? Because he's changing your thinking. What are you telling me I can't sin? Oh, yeah, you can sin. Sure. You can choose, just like any child in any family, to be rebellious. I'm going to go out here and do this anyway, even though my father's instructing me and trying to protect me with his instruction. I'm going to rebel and go do this anyway. How many of you have gotten in trouble for doing that? Amen. Sure, you can sin, and the consequences of sin are not good.
True.
You'll find out that, just like the Bible says, you know, people always say, well, you know, sin is fun for a season. Well, who wants to have fun for a season when you can have it your whole life?
Amen. Yep.
And for eternity. The Bible says godliness is profitable, having the promise of the life that now is and that which is to come.
Yeah.
Oh, it's hard to serve the Lord. Oh, no, the way of the transgressor is hard.
Yeah.
If you believe that it's hard to serve God, you've never served God.
Amen. Yep.
You've never really given Him. Do we have circumstances? Do we get attacked by the devil? Yes. But that's nothing compared to what would happen for those of us who would be out there living with the devil. Some of us probably wouldn't even be here anymore. I know I wouldn't.
That's true.
Yeah. I'm getting off of this. I want to get back on it here real quick. Gotta hurry. It's vain for you to rise up. No sense in worrying, he says. He gives you sleep. Verse 3, lo, children are a heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his rewards. As arrows in the hand of a mighty man, so are the children of youth. Happy is the man that hath his quiver full. Hallelujah. You're like a man with arrows in your quiver. Karen said, sometimes with your kids, this kind of quiver is full. They shall not be ashamed, but they shall speak with the enemies of the gate. One of my favorite psalms, Psalm 112, it says that the seed of the righteous will be mighty warriors.
Yes.
Praise God. Yeah. You don't let the devil tell you what your kids are going to be. You tell him what they're going to be.
Yes. Yeah.
Amen. Yeah. So David gave this a psalm to Solomon, because Solomon was going to be like a father over a nation, a spiritual father over a nation.
Thank you, Lord.
And he was showing him, you're going to have to let God build this house and keep this place.
Yes.
You're going to have to operate in his wisdom. It's a cooperative effort together. Amen?
Yeah.
Psalm 24:3 says, through wisdom a house is built. Proverbs 24:3. Proverbs 9:1 says that wisdom hath builded her house and has hewn out her seven pillars. Think of a house, back in those days, you know, pillars and all that. The wisdom of God, you're walking with God in wisdom like Solomon did here. God is going to build your family. He's going to build your life. He's going to build, and you'll have, you know, pillars are what carries the weight of the house, the roof of the house, right?
Right.
Holds up the house.
Right.
It says here are seven pillars. Seven in the scriptures is a number of perfect completion.
That's right.
Yes.
God's going to do a perfect work to where your house, your home, your life, and your generation is going to be fully complete. As we walk in the wisdom of God. Now, I should have gave you this up front, but I didn't. The definition of wisdom. This is the Pursell paraphrased edition of the dictionary. In other words, this is wisdom in my words, based on what I've read about wisdom. Wisdom. Wisdom is to be able to use or administrate knowledge correctly. See, you can have knowledge. Like, you know, like I was saying earlier, you can know the whole Bible. You can have it all memorized. I know what the Bible says about this. I know what the Bible says. And I should do this, or I could do that. Or you can have all that knowledge. But wisdom is taking God, taking that knowledge and showing you how to use that knowledge and to administrate it to where it becomes a blessing in your life and
yes,
in the life
amen.
That are around you. Everybody remember the famous story about Solomon in the Bible when he first became king? Two women came in. And they both claim the same child.
Yes.
And so Solomon says, okay, well, there's no way of me knowing naturally whose baby this is. So I'll tell you what we'll do. Come here, guard, bring your sword. Hold the child up and split it in half. Give half to that woman and half to that woman. And one of the women started, fell on her face and started crying out, no, please don't do that. Give it to her. And Solomon says, stop, woman. He says, give the baby to her. That's her child. Because only a mama
yeah,
would rather have the baby raised by somebody else than killed before her face.
Right.
That's wisdom.
Yep.
He understood how to use knowledge, administrate over it. See, we get excited about the things of God. I do. How about you? God shows you something. Wow. Woo! Hallelujah. You know, it's like right now, and I'm seeing in the younger generation, signs and wonders. Evangelism. That's all good. And that's what God's doing. And that's the move of God. We're going to see that happen. But you can run out into a move of God with a gift of God, operating in the knowledge of God. And if you don't use wisdom where that thing is concerned in your life,
right.
The devil will use your strengths against you and turn them into weaknesses and take you down.
Yes.
Absolutely.
A man that the Lord used to help mentor me in ministry, Kenneth E. Hagin, when he was a young minister, the healing revival, the tremendous healing revival that was on after World War II was happening. And I've heard him say, he said it was during that time, during that move of God, that season, he said it was the easiest thing in the world to get people healed. It was just easy. And so the move of God was on. And there was many revivalists, many evangelists and people that had big tents and all this kind of stuff. And it was going. And so he was a part of the Voice of Healing, which was a kind of a group of ministers that flowed in that stream, and they would meet together and have different, pastoral gatherings together to encourage one another or whatever. And he said, at one of the meetings, he said, I spoke up, and he said, it wasn't well received, but he said, I knew I needed to say it. The Lord told me to say it. He said to all these ministers, and some of them were younger than him, he said this to them. He said, when all of you are dead and gone, I'll still be here. Boy, who's this guy think he is? He said, because you are basing your ministry on a gift.
Yeah.
And I'm basing my ministry on the Word.
That's right.
In other words, what he's saying is I'm fellowshipping with God every day with His Word, and He's giving me wisdom.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he said, one of the things he said to me is, you need to slow down.
Yeah.
You need to take a nap every afternoon. You're preaching twice a day for 3 weeks. You need not be out running around doing this, that, and the other. Amen?
Yeah.
And he said, every one of those men that were in that room that day, I heard him share this when he was like probably in his 60s or whatever. He said, every one of them were dead and gone. Some of them, he said, around 30 years old, dead and gone.
Yeah.
You know, and one of the old sayings I used to hear in Pentecostal circles years ago, well, I'd rather burn out than rust out.
Yeah.
Why do either one?
Exactly.
Why kill yourself when you can last a long time if you just use wisdom from God to run at the pace God wants you to run at? Amen. Now, I'm not just talking about preachers here right now. I'm talking about life in general. Because we live in a fast-paced life. Have you noticed that? Amen. People are driving and on the cell phone and, you know, and then this and that. You've got to hurry over here. Amen. No time to sit down and take an hour or two and say, Jesus, where am I wrong? Where do I need wisdom? Correct me, Lord. I love you. I want to be in your will, your way. I need wisdom. Look at your neighbor and say, this may be painful, but you needed it today. Hallelujah. Now, Psalm 111, verse 10 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The fear, not fear like afraid of a tornado or afraid of an earthquake. Or what. The fear of the Lord is an attitude of understanding that He's God and you're not. And that because of that, it's an awesome respect and honor for Him and who He is. You know, how would it work at your job every day if you just showed up and you just started doing what you wanted to do? You didn't consult your boss. You didn't find out what he wanted you to do that day. You just went out there and, well, I work here and they're paying me and I know a little bit about what to do around here. You just kept. And every time the boss tried to talk to you, you say, hey, get out of here. I'm busy working. You probably wouldn't be working there very long. Right? We need to be with our boss. We need to be with our Lord. We need to have Him talk to us. Every now and then, say, Lord, where am I deceived? Lord, what do I need to know? I like to get up early in the morning and just get my cup of coffee, praise God, and go over to my lazy boy throne.
Yes.
And rule as a king in the earth. Hallelujah. And just say, Jesus, I worship you. Here I am, Lord. This morning with me, and he deals with everybody different, but this morning with me, he gave me a verse. I turned to it and read it. And then he gave me a page number. I knew it was a page number because there wouldn't be no verse in the Bible with that number. He just does that with me sometimes. And I turned over to the page number, and it was exactly about what the verse was he gave me. So he's talking to me about something. Amen? Praise God. And that's the way he is with us. Praise God. Now, it says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. When you put yourself in that position of under His mighty hand and you realize, I need Him to talk to me. I need to hear Him. I need a relationship with Him. I'm getting the better part of the deal. Because when I get in His presence, just like we did this morning, things happen that I can't manufacture on my own. Amen? I get wisdom. So you live in that place of submission to Him, that place of honoring Him. And then he's able to minister to you. Now, for one last verse, turn with me over to James. Pastor James. James was a pastor. James chapter 1. Praise God. Wisdom is to be able to use or administrate knowledge correctly. God will put people in your life that are more experienced than you are in things. You might call them a spiritual father or a mother. And they've been down the road you're going down. They've experienced things. They've had car wrecks on the road, so to speak. They've gotten off and had to get back on track. You know, our culture, especially since the 60s, I graduated from high school in 69, our culture began to glorify and magnify youth. I remember people in my generation saying, I don't want to live past 30. Don't trust anybody over 30. Are you kidding me? I don't trust anybody under 30. Now, I don't mean that in a wrong way. Don't get me wrong. I'm not throwing rocks at people that are under 30. What I'm saying is that we don't understand the eldership aspect of even just life in general. Now, older folks don't know everything. And if older folks try to make you into them, they're wrong. Every generation generation has its own culture, its own music, its own way of doing things. But there are some things, foundational things in life, that never, ever change.
Preach that. Amen.
And if I see a younger minister, that is, he's running on zeal alone, and he's not using a lot of knowledge, and he's not using a lot of wisdom, then it's my job, if I have a voice in his life, if, you know, he allows me to do that, to come to him and say, whoa, whoa, hold the bus a minute, Jack. I probably won't say it that way. There's got to come into some balance here. Because we don't want you to burn out. We want you to burn long. Amen? Praise God. And so God is going to put pastors, evangelists, teachers, apostles. He's going to put people in your life. He's going to put even people, just somebody maybe you look at them and you don't think they're some kind of apostle or whatever, but they don't have a pulpit ministry, but yet they have a depth of wisdom that they can share with you.
That's right.
You need to ask God, who are the spiritual mothers and fathers in my life? You'll probably find that over your life you can count them all on one hand. But if you plug into them, so to speak, if you allow them to have that voice in your life, and you get around them and you listen to them, they're going to cause you to learn things that you don't have to learn the hard way. You don't need to go to the school of hard knocks. Amen? Well, hallelujah. Amen. James chapter 1. James, a servant of the Lord, or a servant of God, and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. Now, the church is under pressure by the Roman Empire. They are being persecuted. Bad stuff is happening in the world, just like bad stuff is happening in our world today. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into different tests, trials, temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith works patience. See, even what the devil's doing against you, if you handle it right, will work for you. If you handle it wrong, it won't. But you have to have wisdom to know how to handle it.
Yeah.
Go on, are you here?
Yeah. Amen.
But let patience have her perfect work, or a completed work, that you may be completed and perfect, entire, wanting nothing. I used to hear Norval Hayes say this years ago. He said, the patience of God drives the devil nuts.
Yep.
When the devil's pushing on you, you got to get over, you know, he's trying to get you to do something. The Bible says, he that makes haste will sin.
Yep.
And you just sit there and go, shut up, devil. I'm just going to wait on the Lord here until I hear from him.
Right.
He's like,
Come on, don't do that.
Amen.
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 He's trying to use your own emotion against you, your own frustration, the spirit of fear, whatever it is. But the Bible says in Isaiah, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They're going to mount up with wings like an eagle and fly in a high place and see things from God's heavenly perspective.
Amen.
As they spend time with God. Amen?
Amen.
Some, you know, and I believe in going into all the world. I believe in going through every door that's open to you. I believe in always being willing to be a witness as God opens the doors for you. I believe in giving, you know, words of knowledge to people and blessing people. But I also know that you can get religiously zealous and try to do things God hasn't called you to do yet.
Right.
And you can be religiously lazy and not do what he's telling you to do.
Yeah.
Amen? Yeah. And so we need to stay with him and stay in that place of wisdom. Verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, how many people in here lack wisdom? Everybody should have raised their hand. Because there are some areas in your life right now.
Yes.
There again, don't take this wrong. I'm not saying you're bad or you're rebellious. There are things in your life, circumstances in your life right now, situations in your life, maybe even in your relationship between you and the Lord, you don't have wisdom.
Yes.
And he wants to give you that wisdom.
Yes.
Or maybe you've got a situation like this where you're being attacked by the devil. There's family trouble. There's things that are happening. And you're trying to fix it. You're trying to be what you need to be in it and make it happen. And things just aren't happening. He says here, if any lack wisdom, let that person ask of God.
Yep.
That gives to all people liberally.
Yes.
God says, man, I want to dump my wisdom on you. I want you to have a bucket load of wisdom.
Yes.
And upbraideth not, or in other words, he won't mock you when you ask him. He won't chide you. He won't, you know, make fun of you.
All right.
Come on. Well, I don't want to ask a stupid question. There aren't any. Amen. There's only stupid people that don't ask questions.
Amen.
The gifts all men liberally and upbraids not, and it shall be given him.
Right.
What if you ask?
Yeah.
I remember one time years ago, this one scripture was, in my life has come periodically, and I think about it, and I mean, I don't know what that means. Finally, one day, I'm talking like years later, I said, Lord, what does that mean? And he just click.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I see
yeah,
that.
I love that.
I said, why didn't you show me that before? He said, you never asked me. All I did was run around wondering about it. I wonder.
That's true, man.
Quit wondering
and
start asking.
Yeah.
Amen.
Now, here's the thing about God. The scriptures say the foolishness of God is wiser than the wisdom of man.
Yes.
See, man's wisdom is really not wisdom. It's incomplete wisdom. Matter of fact, if we had time, James talks about it in this book. He talks about the wisdom of man. Opens up the door to everything demonic. Eventually. And we've seen that in our nation. If you lived as long as I've lived, you've watched it. You watched it move into where now the devil can get on TV and name TV shows, Lucifer! And everybody just goes, oh, okay. Oh, what's that? Moving right along, hallelujah. The Bible says that if the wisdom of God is wiser than the wisdom of man. But listen to me now, listen to this. Over in Isaiah 55, it says, God says, my ways, or in his wisdom because of his ways, are not your ways. But as high as the heavens are above the earth, so are my ways more superior than your ways. And how many of you, remember the story of Jesus? Some guy needed his eyes open. Jesus spits on the ground. Rubs his finger in the spittle in the dirt, makes clay, puts it on the guy's eyes. And says, go wash the pool of Siloam. Now we read the whole story and we're, oh, miracle. But you put yourself in that guy's shoes.
Yeah.
I need to be healed. What's he doing? He's spitting?
Yeah.
God. Now what's he doing? He's going to rub it on my eyes? That's the craziest, foolish, goofy thing I've ever heard in my life. Do what? Go wash it over there in that water? That's going to do this?
Yeah.
How foolish does that sound? But it was the wisdom of God. It was the wisdom of God. Over in 1 Corinthians 1, Paul says, 1 Corinthians 1 and 2, he says, when I come to preach, I don't come to preach to you out of the wisdom of man. He said, I yield to the Holy Ghost, and I say whatever he tells me to say.
The Holy Ghost.
Because I want your faith based on the power of God and how he operates.
Yes.
Not man trying to figure it out.
Yeah. Amen.
We've had in this nation, 40 years, if not more, of man trying to figure it out. And we are in worse shape than we were when we started that.
Yes.
If the truth be told.
Yes.
For the last 40 years, all you've been hearing is half-truths and outright lies, mostly. I mean, back when I was in school, I never one day in my life went to school thinking, uh-oh, somebody might shoot me today.
That's right. Amen.
Somebody might have thrown a spitball at me, stuck gum in my ear, or did something else crazy like that, paper airplanes. Oh, but we've progressed a lot. Our children are really have got it together. We don't want to admit the truth. It's called pride. They were mocking Jesus one day, and he said, wisdom will be shown of her children. It'll all come out in the wash. You'll see the wisdom of God. Now, you and I have to understand that because of, especially our access to cell phones, TV, all of this going on around, we are constantly being blasted with the so-called wisdom of men. Now, I'm not saying it's all bad, scientific knowledge and understanding all. I'm not saying everything that's happened in the last 40, 50 years has been bad. I'm not saying that. But you have to learn to discern,
rightly discern.
That's right.
And the only way you're going to be able to do that is if you let God give you wisdom. You can be in your generation, just like Solomon was in his generation. You can walk in a place. See, it all has to do with a servant's heart. Don't live your life to be blessed. Live your life to be a blessing. Because the scriptures teach whatever you live your life to be is what you're going to get back. So if I'm over here as a taker, that's all I care about. You can go to hell. I'm just going to get mine. Guess what's going to happen to me? I'm going to find myself lost out in the spiritual wilderness somewhere.
Yes.
But if I live my life to be a blessing to God and blessing to people every day, then I'm going to give back blessings. That's what he was telling Solomon. You live your life, you ask with the right heart. You said, I just want to be the king these people need me to be.
Yeah.
I want to glorify you and be a blessing to these people every day. God says, ooh, I love to hear that kind of prayer request.
Amen.
And I'm going to give you the wisdom to do that because your will, I'm going to give you the desire of your heart because your desire lines up with my desire.
Yes.
And by the way, you're going to get wealth, long life, and victory your whole life.
Right.
It's all part of the package.